Welcome to our March Performance and Quality Committee meeting. I guess we'll start with introductions. Just go around. I'm Billy Kennedy. I guess I'm the chair of this board, of this committee. Don't need more responsibility.
I'm Pat McGinnis.
I'm Jack Cohn.
Public Mary Short. Public Katie Short.
Thank you.
Kathy Jackson Edgerton. Julie Sinclair.
Thank you. Well, I guess I need a motion to approve the agenda first.
We have an addition.
Oh, that's right. With an addition, Jack wanted to add a discussion at the end.
Yes.
So I guess I need a movement with that change to the agenda. All in favor? Aye. Okay. Now we need a motion to approve the minutes from September 2015 and February 2016.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
I saw the February ones.
I think the second September ones were in the
I'll
give you a minute to glance.
Yeah, I just like to be sure.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Take your time.
I open my mouth. I'll second that. Just spelling is con C A H. Everything wants to come out C H in this
spell. C A H. I thought it was with a K, but it's a C, isn't it?
C A H. King of the German.
Oh, good. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, minutes are approved. First thing we'll do is the monthly reports and the performance improvement.
So the performance improvement here looks like this. Yes. And unfortunately, that's the monthly report. But it's not that one with the big writing. That's actually an internal document, and it's fine. It feeds this. I didn't tell you which. I didn't give you good enough instructions.
We got more information than we need, but that's okay.
But it's this one. So, I really didn't have any highlights on here other than item number 2 on page 2 should be removed because we've met it for 3 consecutive quarters. So, I'm going to remove that one.
And that's the health and safety, you're saying?
Health and safety, yes.
Okay.
Medication error. I forgot to tell her to remove the. So there really is no change until you get to page 5.
We were pretty close on the communication bulletins and just moving in the right direction, I guess.
Page 5, the provider satisfaction survey results, they've been added to this report. What we do is we will look at the report in detail towards the end.
We didn't know if you were going to be still or on the finance.
We
didn't know if you were still or on finance. We'd love to have you if you want.
I thought I was on finance too, but they sent me a packet for performance.
Well, then she didn't know you changed to finance. So whatever you want to do, we'd love to have you, but whatever you want.
I'll go in here.
We'd love to have you, Michael.
That didn't come out right. I'm sorry.
He likes money more than dollars.
It didn't come out right. It looked like they didn't have any in there, is what I was...
Oh, I see. That's funny, Michael.
All of
the
money, you'll learn a lot.
Thank you. We'll see you at the big meeting.
I am going to make that comment on my YouTube channel so people find that on the video. That was very sweet, everybody. Sorry, I'll be quiet.
So anyway, we had methodology for selecting which items on the provider satisfaction survey we were going to target for internal quality improvement activities. And those were items for which we scored 10% or below the state aggregate, and items for which we went down. So if our performance went down, we made an internal corrective action, and if our performance was more than 10% below the state aggregate, we selected to target those.
So being a little proactive on this here too, I guess.
Even though we trended up on those items, if we were still 10% below the state aggregate, we chose to address them.
Okay. And we do want to get to that state aggregate or above. So.
And then for the items on page 7, the DMH measures, I just want to point out that the state gives us our standings 6 months after our report is sent in. So we only found out in February that we were out of compliance in July of 2015. So you see our out of compliance numbers, and what we have is in the column, we have our numbers for the quarter that we just submitted. We have some where we've already come up, in other words. So the items in green, the items number 5.7, all those came up, and the last item came up. So.
And these are, even though you just started, now that start date, would that be other, some of those you were working on already? We were working on.
This was fiscal year so far, right?
First quarter. The start date is 3/15 because that's when the report came out.
Okay.
And no, we didn't have any of these on here before.
Okay, so these that we did it corrected, we were already doing things to correct them before we even got this report. And they just happened to show up because they hadn't gotten where we wanted them yet.
Yes.
Okay. Any more discussion on that?
So again, these are primarily our way of tracking our internal selected corrective actions. It's not a mandate. It's just our tracking our activities.
I guess the biggest thing that concerns me, and this may be that they don't show up as a follow-up after they be discharged from hospital or ADAC or somewhere.
Again, all of them get appointments.
Okay. So it's
within 5 days of their discharge. You're correct.
And that's that transportation and how we get them there. Is that program with MAHEC, I guess it's such a small percentage where they're actually going out in the community looking for people, that's just a small number, isn't it?
I don't know. We haven't separated out how that impacts.
But it's the same thing in our county. I was in our DSS and Project on Aging meeting recently, and transportation's a big issue in the mountain communities.
Does LOS stand for in 5.3?
Length of service?
Okay.
And we can point it out and encourage it, but there's not a lot we can do for that transportation issue.
I'm glad you mentioned that, Pat, because that length of service, it's not 8.3%, it's 8.3 days. That one measure is not a percentage, it's actually measured in days.
Okay.
I know when we were moving the provider, we had vehicles as part of our provider. So the idea of transportation associated with a service is not unheard of, but I guess we don't do that.
We don't go get people for appointments, do we? We don't pick them up.
If people have Medicaid, then the problem is there are some limited amounts of transportation and it takes advanced scheduling, and
sometimes
they can't.
5 days is not even enough advance notice to schedule.
Because they're using, we've got Apple Card in Watauga County, but they've got, there's some public transportation that uses that funding and has, goes out into the county too.
But
same thing, they're trying to duplicate rides and stuff, and so you may not be able to get a ride on the day of your appointment.
Right. Right.
But are we pretty flexible if they find the ride to change their appointment to when they can come?
It depends on what center it is, because all of the comprehensive care centers are required to take walk-ins. So the answer is yes.
Depending on
who's... If it's a comprehensive care center, then yes, they have to be flexible by the very nature of their business.
Okay.
But you still have the same criteria for the length of time when you have to get them in. That's not going to change because they changed it and fell outside that window, which is a problem with mandates, state mandates, but that's what they are.
And transportation is a statewide issue, other than the urban, really urban areas. Yeah. Like if you look at, I still can't quite figure out how Alexander County is an urban area.
A lot of it is.
I was in Durham most of last week at the VA with John.
The
amount of different transportation companies contracting and providing transportation to folks in that area was just, I stood there and just with my mouth open and just watched. It's like a different world here.
Well, you have that concentration of numbers, the population that...
have enough business to support it.
And I was like, man, if I was in Durham and I was having a job, I mean, there's thousands of jobs doing that down there.
We have communities that can't even support taxi services.
We could
give vouchers for taxi services.
Well, it's something I know we're looking at the other boards I'm on too. So it's a problem, and it unfortunately hits the low-income people the hardest. Okay, anything else on that?
No other highlights.
Moving right along to our February data then.
There really aren't any highlights. We met all of our standards. Every measure that's associated with the standard, we met or exceeded the standard, so our combined data looks good. Our second page is state and block grant data. All of those standards are met. And our third page, our Medicaid data, we met all our standards on that, and our ED visits for MHDD or SU diagnoses continue to drop, and we hope that's because of our quality improvement project that we're doing in collaboration with providers.
Okay. I saw something that was this readmission that went up.
The inpatient continues to be high, and some readmits, but our ED use is going down.
And I guess, I know they don't want to see readmits, but in the mental health, on the other hand, is it sometimes just part of the process, I guess if you think you're being served properly, they wouldn't need to be readmitted by the, whether it's medication or visits or whatever.
A lot of it's probably that they couldn't get a bed the first time they went in, and they really did need to be admitted.
Would have been admitted. So a readmission is somebody who is discharged, and then they go back within 30 days.
We have frequent flyers, and they're severely ill people, and you do everything you can to be sure that they're as stable as possible in their home environment, and they fail and they have to be readmitted. That's the only thing that keeps hospitals going, is the frequent flyers that are very sick. And I'm sure that there's corollaries in the behavioral health.
They may not take their medication.
Yeah, there may be a lot of reasons besides the quality of care that they're receiving for that readmission. But those cases all need to be looked at, obviously, if there's a small chunk that's accounting for a large proportion of that, then obviously some intensive outside-the-box thinking needs to be done to what support or what care they need that will keep them from inpatient.
Right. And
too obvious, I guess, but...
We're beginning, we've st- started a, what's called a rapid readmit reduction, and rapid readmits are those that occur within 30 days of discharge. Mm-hmm. And fairly soon, as it gets better developed, we're going to invite providers to collaborate with us on that project as well.
Okay, so we've got a plan working on that, and some people looking into that, whether it's a specific group or whatever. And I do agree, and that it's a small group that uses a lot, a high percentage of the services, but they need them.
Well, yes, but they may be, if they're accounting for a high percentage of things like readmissions that we don't think are good things, then we're limited, and, we can't say case manager, but
care coordinator.
They have a care coordinator, and they have, frequent outpatient visits, and they have family support, but they still end up, being readmitted, and we need to think of something else. That's all.
Yeah, as far as why and what we could do to reduce that. Or whether all their needs are being met while they're in the facility. I mean, when they're released, should they have really been released?
There's a push for, that's an area to look at. And I don't know how that works. I guess Medicaid puts pressure on the inpatient facilities to get them out of inpatient care.
Yeah, I don't know.
Efficiently and quickly. They certainly do it for
Medicaid. Yeah.
So that's all I know. But I wonder if that can certainly be part of it, because there may be an incentive on the part of the inpatient facilities, besides just having beds available. There may be an incentive for them to district people.
I don't know what the incentive would be, unless it's filling it with a private patient.
So, well, sometimes
a higher rate.
If they had, for instance, if they have a global fee instead of a day fee.
We have daily rates.
Yeah. Okay.
So they don't have any incentive, really. So we've taken that away. So
I don't know. Yeah.
Let's keep looking at it. It's going to be better. Enough on that. And we've got the executive summary next.
It just repeats what we looked at.
I'm just going over.
Mm-hmm. It's a nice summary.
That was good. And paraphrase as well as y'all put it in here.
Yeah.
I kind of skim over. And then February tripping slides.
I don't know if there are any questions about those. Those just let you see the year in review. And nothing jumped out at me when I looked at it.
Yeah, one thing jumped out at me is how fast we answer calls.
We do answer very quickly.
Because when you think about it, the timer starts when the connection's made. It's not even ringing.
That's right, yeah.
Because they're on a cycle ringing.
Yeah.
It may be like 2 or 3 seconds where it rings. Mm-hmm. And you're still under 6 seconds. That's incredible.
And that's all out of this center right here?
Yes.
Yeah, because I got the tour, and it's pretty amazing. So, well, when you're in that right.
Yes, you know, there's a couple of things I'm going to say. I think it might pertain to this committee.
Sure.
For one, some of you may know that we had a female client, or somebody had a female client that was being transported, or they went to get her by ambulance. She was a mental health client. She was transported to the hospital in McDowell County within the last month. And somehow or another, she managed to get in the driver's seat of the ambulance and steal the ambulance and leave with it and go down the road and wreck the ambulance. And one of the things that struck me on the news was basically they said in the last year or a couple of years they had 3 times as many calls to go pick up these kind of clients to transport them by ambulance to the hospital. And then I saw the death data on some of this, which looked pretty high to me, and maybe I paid particular attention to it this month, because earlier in the month, John, my mate, we had suicide in his family. It was he was a 34-year-old veteran who had PTSD from Burke County, but actually it was one of John's cousin's mm-hmm. children, and so, there were just some areas maybe we need to look at. I don't know what we could do different, but try to do better.
Well, those ambulance drivers need to take the keys with them when they leave the ambulance. They had an ambulance sitting outside the gate at ASU, and one of the other ambulances called by and said, "I thought y'all were supposed to be at the game." And somebody, one of the kids, taken it and drove it up to one of the student housing complexes.
When I worked at West Union, it's an officer.
They're running generators and stuff, but they need to be there.
When it came to the high rise to get an inmate or something, they'd leave the door open and the keys in it and it running. And I was like, you know, you got inmates walking around out here cutting the grass. This might not be the smartest thing, but it's their procedure.
One of my favorite movies, Quiet on the Luke.
Well, so that's for an ambulance issue, but the death issue, I agree.
It just seemed like a lot of deaths to me. Maybe some of them are natural, I guess they all are.
A lot of them are, but.
And one was a fire, I thought, or there was a fire.
There was a fire.
At a provider then?
I don't recall.
We don't know where it is.
Suicide is such a difficult problem. I mean, there's so much energy directed at prevention, so much community awareness stuff, so much, and I've never seen, in my 40 years, I've never seen anything impact the rate, except removing things that let people be impulsive. So if there's not a railing on a bridge that's very hard to climb over, if there is a gun available, if there's not, as long as you take away the impulsive things, you can affect some suicides. But that's about the only thing I've seen that has any impact on that. And it's such a tragedy.
Maybe we need to do more community education when people are getting discharged with their families or something. My stepmother committed suicide, and she went home and she shot herself right after getting out of the hospital. And I'm like, well, where'd she get the gun?
Right.
You know, and they're like, oh, well, they're all over the house in drawers,
So the one thing at DSS, best thing the Child Protective Services that I'm on, they take trigger locks for free and give them to them, and they walk into these houses full of guns, and they say, you know, they're not trying to take the guns away, but here, how about trigger locks? And they're like, oh, great. So
it's a little bit,
you know, it's the first positive sign I've seen that really is working towards, and I had a friend, I spoke to him on the phone, three hours later, he shot himself and killed himself. So it's hard to know how to stop that. But like you say, in the societies that make it harder to kill yourself, there's a lower suicide rate. But I think I heard that, 2/3 of the gun deaths in the United States are suicides?
Well, my next neighbor killed himself a couple years ago. Maybe. You know, and Michael and I, we live fairly close to each other in the main street that runs near our house. We've had, for no more houses than on that street, we've had a tremendous amount of suicides.
Well, ASU had, it wasn't statistically odd, but they had quite a few last year. And they've done whole surveys and reached out. And one of our friend's daughters, they put her on one of the serotonin things right away, and that didn't work. So she's transitioning now. And there is that risk that during that time when they're changing medications or going off one on the other, that they often, from what I've read, have a more likely to commit suicide there. That's one of the side effects or risks of those.
Well, actually, that's the other thing. People who are coming out of depression, one of the thoughts is that when you're severely depressed, you can't organize your thoughts well.
Okay.
And that as you come out and you can think about things, you figure out what you want to do. I mean, that's a thought about it. Mm-hmm. The other is that people don't ever want to go back there.
Right.
They'll say, if I could ever feel that horrible again, I don't want to take the chance.
Anything's better than that. Okay.
Yeah, that's another thought, but nobody knows.
And I believe our society has got a lot of people that just have no value. I mean, in the way they're recognized in society, and that's hard for people to be marginalized when they're seeing everything else going on all around them. So, well, hopefully we can help with that some too, Pat. So, on to our December 2015 LME MCO comparison.
That's the document that looks like this. The highlights for this are, the first highlight is on page 3. If you'll notice that our percentage of uninsured who receive services through state funded is the highest in the state, and it's been the highest for the 4 out of the past 5 months. So that means we really are doing a lot with our money. We have a good penetration rate, and we're reaching a lot of people, which isn't to be said we're reaching everyone who needs it, but
no, that is
that's
good.
Something.
Because a lot of those people that are uninsured don't, or even more hesitant to get into services.
So that's the one highlight. The others are.
We also are serving a great catchment population through the.
Through.
And the others, that first graph on it.
Yes, we are.
And then we're going to say about the consumer authorized appeals. That we were kind of high there, but on page 4, I guess I'm on page 4 now.
Right. I just think that says a lot for how we encourage people to speak for themselves, and because our appeal rate is very low, but our appeal percentage is a little higher than some.
What does the appeals process look like? Do they meet with you folks? Do they fill out a form? Is it 10 smoky people and one client sitting in a room? Or
it can be done in person or by phone. It's whatever the person would like. It's a 3-tiered process. We offer a local reconsideration first, and it can be the person. They can have a representative with them. But they get a verbal explanation of why the service was denied. They can talk on their behalf. Their representative can talk on their behalf. Sometimes there are negotiations, and with new information, something different is decided. If the appeal is, or the reconsideration is upheld, and the original decision still stands, then the individual can file for a fair hearing with the Office of Administrative Hearings. And anyone who files for a fair hearing in the Office of Administrative Hearings is required to go through a mediation before
that process. Do they have to go to Raleigh, or does the office?
That can be by phone. Even the hearing can be by phone. So any part of it can be by phone. But the mediation has then, in addition to the people who are present at the local reconsideration, it has a third-party mediator, an unbiased mediator. And then if that isn't successful or the individual isn't pleased with the result of that, then they go to the state fair hearing. That's the process.
Do we have a report of the number of requests that are, the number of
that are
denials that are reversed?
I can get that.
I would show you how accurate
we
are.
We have a very low reversal rate.
Okay. Yeah, well, I would think it was such a low rate of denial. That too speaks to accuracy.
Mm-hmm. The next highlight, again, it's on page 7, and again, it has to do with persons served. So it so happens in December, we had the highest penetration rate for Medicaid consumers as well. So not only for the uninsured, but for Medicaid consumers. And we have maintained a presence in the top 3 penetration rates for quite a while. And so in August we were 3rd in the state, September we were 1st, October we were 3rd in the state, November we were 2nd highest penetration rate, in December again first time. So we're really doing very well. The other highlight that I have to point out is on page 8. It's a little, it's not good news. The first two were good news. We have a high hospitalization rate.
high number of people going into psychiatric hospitalization, highest in the state.
And
okay,
do we know why?
Yeah, that's very complex, you know.
It is.
It may mean we're identifying.
It may.
Yeah.
That's a good way to look at it.
Well, and it may mean that we don't have adequate outpatient support. So, I mean, we need a lot of information as to whether that's a good or bad number.
Right, and that committee, that project, they're working on looking at that.
So they'll get back to us with...
Yeah, yeah.
And they should find something out.
And I don't know if you have questions about any of the other data presented.
We are. That's the EDUs. We are below the state average on that.
Mm-hmm. We have fairly high admissions, but very low readmits.
And that may not be bad. I mean, you know, it's
useful.
I'm glad we're not trillion.
I wonder if, is that admits to any psychiatric facility from an emergency room, or is that only state?
Which one?
The inpatient.
What?
Our inpatient rate.
It.
Is that anywhere in the
state?
It's one, another factor might simply be...
Pretty sure it's community hospitals.
Well, I thought we had a low availability of beds.
Yeah, is that only for psychiatric, behavioral diagnosis?
It's psychiatric hospitalization,
psychiatric,
yes.
Psychiatric, mm-hmm. At community facilities, okay.
So that'd be like Cannon?
Yes.
And
Fry. And Mission.
Mission.
So would that, so one thing that might correlate inversely is the length of time people have to stay in the emergency. In other words, if you have available inpatient beds, you may have people that are being admitted within a few hours if they're being identified with any inpatient care, whereas people who have to wait 2 days may eventually be reassessed and go home.
And did we read
But you
an
said
article?
They were admitted anyhow, though, didn't you?
Those are admitted, but
okay.
But to his point, I think I read an article, it might have been last week, that last Monday, there were 20 people in the Watauga ED with behavioral health issues. Did you read that article?
Yes.
It could be. I get the sheriff's log, and we spend a lot of time. Now, we are working with the hospital. They sit on the people.
They did a really good job of placing them. So it was just about the anomaly of having that many people in the ED, that none of them had overly significant long... it's long, but nowadays, yes, comparatively.
And I guess it varies as to what the IVC score is, to whether they're admitted or not.
No, anybody who's IVC is required to be contained for 72 hours.
But they have a test they do for them. And I see it regularly. If they score a 6, then they let them go. If it's higher, they take them to Cannon.
Well, that's an internal their process. They would have to actually sign a legal paper dismissing the commitment because the commitment's
good for
72 hours.
I think this is before the IVC. This is a certain test.
So they do
test,
a screening.
Screening, that's what I guess I'm saying.
At the magistrates or something like that.
No, it's usually at the hospital because... Well, the sheriffs have all done the CIT training with Smokey, all the deputies, our provider, Daymart, has people that can go out too. But the deputies are usually the first person there, and if they need it, they take them to the hospital, and then they don't have to stay with them if the hospital security, they work, we've got an agreement.
I really shouldn't have warned up about that. That's what my daughter does for them.
She
does
mobile crisis?
She does assessments
and
emergency
rooms.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So,
and,
but we don't talk business.
Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah. I'd love to hear about this. How it works.
Well, good. So anything else on that?
No. Not that I have.
And then we had the DOG settlement, too. And these are some we're tracking, and some the state is tracking?
I don't know what the difference between the data is. The tracking, our internal, we have, he, because our numbers vary from the state's, he puts both our numbers versus the state numbers on there.
Oh, okay, so that's not duplicated.
Like we're doing more than we've tracked, and sometimes the state makes us look like we're doing less than we've tracked.
So which would be the number that would be the best to pay attention to?
Our number.
I was talking to Marty Nicely Thursday, and she was talking about an article or something on Smokey's website. I'm going to have to read that she was complimenting Smokey.
I think, yeah, we get good reviews from her.
Yeah, the biggest thing having to overcome in my area is New River. There's still negative feelings, even though it was problems preceding Smokey coming into the picture. So. All right, shall we move on to our we have quarterly reports to be okay?
I didn't really see any outliers or anything to report on the grievance summary. I did, just so you know,
tell them that
this is too much for this committee, that we need a dashboard, so we won't always get this much information.
This is this one here.
Yeah, because this committee is more about Smokey's performance as an MCO. And so really the measures that you would want to pay attention to are on page...
Because we have a grievance committee that's doing this work regularly.
The Human Rights Committee looks at this in detail.
Okay.
So what you would want to, as a board, and looking at Smokey's performance, you would want to see how long it takes us to resolve a grievance, which... Is it 9? There we go, yes. So the federal law gives us 90 days. State regulations give us 30 days. Our internal goal is 15 days. But as you can see, each quarter we've only had one that's gone outside the 30-day window.
That's good. And those are either resolved by mediation or that one of those.
No,
that's not, that doesn't follow that. It's a different process. We have grievance specialists who look into the issue and do little informal reviews.
Okay.
They may get sent for an investigation if the informal review has discovered something that they think needs
I like
attention.
The fact that you had this complaints and grievances summary by the service top.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was interesting that it was the residential services and outpatient services that were when most of that was. But that is that a large percentage of our services?
Yeah, well, we find that the services that touch the person more, such as residential or say ACT, there's more interaction, have more grievances, and the outpatient, most of the outpatient services complaints are about medication management, people not getting the medications they want, people not getting refills on time, people not understanding that there are some medications for which they need to show up and be seen and get a physical prescription to take.
And with that, they're safer than it would be with the other services.
For medication management,
For a variety of things. I mean, they're worse off, or they wouldn't have ACT, probably.
Oh, for ACT,
they have multiple symptoms.
Yes.
Okay,
ACT.
Yeah.
I thought you said that.
No,
ACT. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else on that?
No, I don't know.
When I talked the percentages of served, I thought that was good. Grievances, and you'd see that, but and then you get a percentage, and
it's low.
It's low, but then it's even hard to tell. I mean, you can't even. It's not like one county is any. Just, I mean, the We're talking as well, but we have only 10 of the people being served to bunk them, so. Okay, anything else on that?
Provider satisfaction survey.
That's the.
That's coming up.
That's coming up.
Did we do the incident report yet?
No.
Okay. Let's do the incident report.
I don't.
Didn't see much.
No.
Out of normal there.
No.
I'm getting kind of used to some of these jerks you guys. Have to slow myself down and make sure I'm still looking to catch things, but. Yeah, I thought that was okay. That looked pretty good to me. Anything else on that? Then we'll go to the access to care from the second quarter. Second quarter, and what's that also?
So this is, we had talked about this earlier as we were, people were entering the meeting, that this is about keeping appointments, not making appointments. We only have control over making the appointments, so it's, we do reminder calls. We do everything we can to get the person to attend their appointment, but we still have these rates. So.
And so, like I say, we're looking at it in a lot of different ways of, and maybe even finding some other transport. I mean, I know we were, my sister was telling me not to drive. She lives in Black Mountain, not to drive on the interstate. She got a whole list of cabs companies and here, you know, put a road for her. But we don't know how that works. Okay, so moving on to our provider satisfaction survey. This is when we thought we'd spend a little time.
So, yes, so I'm going to go over the highlights, and then if you want to ask questions. The highlights are, we went up on 17 of the 23 questions. So we made a lot of improvements. Unfortunately, we went down on the others. We were above the state average on only two of the measures.
These are, so none of this really fit into our previous data?
Maybe. Well, these questions, if you look at them, they're really not anything that we can measure.
Yeah, informative and helpful.
And the, but the other point of it is, if you look at, say, question 11, our claims are processed in timely and accurate manner, 87% positive. Well, if you look at our claims data, we're required to process claims within 30 days of its being received, and we have almost 99% of our claims processed. So it's a marketing thing or a education.
Because the claims are being processed.
Yes.
And the customers, the clients,
right,
are not realizing that they're being processed.
Correct. And in 23.
Or the providers. Yeah, this is the provider.
Authorizations are processed within the required time frames. Well, we have 100% compliance right there. So the fact that only 76% satisfaction about that is not necessarily a dissatisfaction. I mean, isn't saying that we don't process it within the time frame. Maybe they disagree with the required time frame. So we have to do some education on some of these.
And so that will be provider education. And I guess, I mean, some of these are pretty big providers too. So they have a whole accounting office, and they have their things could perhaps be slowed down in their process.
Let's look at that. Go, if you go to page 5, I'm going to have us look at page 5 before we look at page 4. Or no, let's go to page 4. Page 4, we had a very high response rate, and we had almost 43% of our respondents were independent practitioners, which means I'm a therapist with a shingle outside my door. Those the scores given by those individuals were much, much lower than for the agencies and brought us down.
There are a lot of those in this area, too.
Yes. When there are a lot of those in the Asheville area. Mm-hmm. So if you look at, on 17 of 23 of the questions, the LIPs had a high rate, a high, much higher rate of dissatisfaction or a lower rate of satisfaction. And because they were almost 50% of our respondents, they did pull down the scores.
Do you know if the other EMCOs had that percentage of LIPs?
They have much lower
percentage. We never had scores like this before we merged with this particular area.
Western Islands, okay.
That's true.
Well, so we're working on that. I guess that's
yes,
that's doing the provider, those meetings with the providers, and well, do they come? I mean,
well, you know, the hard part of that, Billy, is that our provider advisory council is self-governed. So to rate the MCO for a process that is self-governed, we can inform our provider advisory council about the scores and about the feedback. And we can encourage things, but our impact is only indirect because we cannot, because it's self-governed.
Unless it doesn't meet our standards of service, and then we can stop.
The provider advisory council is, I don't know that we're going to go back to having a smoky run provider network meeting. I don't.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a. And Duncan would be, if she was here, he'd be a good one to ask
yes,
about that.
Yes, because
so,
he's the president of that.
Right. So, well, next time he's here, we'll see what he thinks on that.
Okay.
I was speaking to another one, Michael Mabee, who does for Talk Opportunities, and he's on the council, too.
Is Duncan an LIP or?
Agency. And this report is going to be shared with the provider advisory council at the April meeting.
Okay.
It didn't make it to the March meeting, it made it to the April meeting.
It would be good to get their feedback on it.
So they will see it on April 20th. April 20th. Mm-hmm. And then what you had mentioned earlier on page 5, they included the no responses in the denominator, which mm-hmm. essentially lowers your percentage of satisfaction. And it's not even that the no responses were somebody failing to answer a question. It was a choice. And they selected, I have no response to this question.
So they don't just throw that one out.
Right. So if you throw it out,
yeah.
Then of course you see our percentage of satisfaction recalculated is a little bit higher, but still not where we want it.
And it's still not looking good compared to the others. I wonder, like you say, if it is the higher percentage of LIPs responding to this than the other LMEMCOs have, but we're still not the ranking that I'd like to see us on that
right.
last page. On
nor would we, yeah.
But there is an interesting dynamic for the providers. I mean, there's their motivation is a little different than the network.
Yes.
They're each individually trying to pay their bills, mm-hmm. but the network has so it's tricky. So, mm-hmm. well, I'll be looking forward to hearing what Duncan reports back on that, so we can get his input on that. And I'm hoping. Well, that was the most disappointing I've seen since I've come to this committee. So I'm hopefully I won't see a lot more of that. But anything else?
Just
on that. Yeah. Then any other business?
Okay.
Yeah, I've got him next. I've got a what is this
follow-up? Oh, follow-up from
yes.
February.
I mean, I had a couple things.
Back in February, I showed you the backup staffing report and the number of hours missed and the you asked me how, what percentage of the service is at, it's 0.93% of services, so it's less than 1% of service missed.
So that's pretty small.
0.93, less than 0.93.
And I think that's, we talked about everything that, I don't know, it's there, I think so, I think that's it. And then Jack, you got the floor.
I'm gonna ask some questions, and then I'll give a little sign.
Do, somebody, y'all got the time, watch the time?
It's 3:51.
3:51.
Got 9 minutes?
Okay.
And we usually go over, so.
Who does, who's the quality assurance stuff?
The QM, well, we've just reorganized a bit, but we have a QM department, and we, in that department or team, there's the system performance team, and the system performance team does the measures, the internal audits. So it's under the direction of the QM director.
So the certain staff?
Yes.
Get into that, who have other jobs?
No.
Oh, that's their only job, is to?
Correct.
How do you select what we're going to monitor?
The, a lot of the depart, well, a lot of it is based on state mandate and state measures and where we fall, for example, in surveys or reports. But then, and then other requirements, such as we always want to do inter-rater reliability for items that involve scoring, such as authorizations or monitorings. And then, we also have a quality improvement committee, which tracks performance and suggests quality improvement projects. So it's kind of a dual approach, the department and then the committee, which is made up of some members of all departments in Smoky. But we let the departments pretty much select where they think they need to improve and what they need to target for the internal audits outside of things that aren't regulated or mandated.
Do they get input about problems, in other words?
Yes.
And those would be from complaints or from?
From a variety of places, so they might come from external grievances. It might come from internal trends, like other departments noticing that something isn't working real well, or they're having trouble collaborating with them, or their own internal, they notice their own internal needs for improvement.
What is the authority of the committee? Problems identified and somebody thinks they've got a way of making it better, then what happens?
Then the committee can recommend that a quality improvement project be looked into. Generally, people want to improve their quality enough that they come up with their own quality improvement projects. Mm-hmm. But that committee has a subcommittee called the Quality Improvement Project Subcommittee. It's just a smaller subset that looks at project proposals and makes sure that they are in line with what, sort of like a research paper, a research question, the QIP process and the requirements for that. So that committee looks at the proposals, make sure they can get a baseline, make sure that what they're saying they're measuring is actually measuring what they want to improve.
Right.
And all that sort of thing, and helps them develop that. But we, in addition to quality improvement projects, we have quality improvement activities that aren't formal projects, that aren't measured and tracked, because a project has a formulation period where you gather a baseline, and then
yes,
the project lasts for a year, and then you follow it for a year to make sure.
It's a long cycle.
To make sure that the change that you have implemented has been sustained.
I'll just say a couple of things. You certainly monitor the things that you do all the time and that generate numbers, because those are the easy things to do, and they're and you can say, where did that number come from? And then you note that there's a problem. The other set of monitoring are things that are dangerous, is how I like to think about it. So, you know, readmissions, that's, you know, there's a, that means somebody's fallen through the cracks. Well, that's dangerous because it's life and death sometimes.
Right.
So things that are dangerous, or I guess that are acute or serious or whatever, even if they're, those should always be monitored, even if there's not any, even if you might go a month or two with no data or something.
Right.
And that's just, you know, I mean, I've done QA for 40 years. And that's just my slant on it. And one of the things I noted today was it said, well, there were not, you know, the mid-error rate was low, and so we don't need to look at that anymore. But you're still looking at that, I hope. And that, because I think, as we talked about last time,
that's still looked at.
We need to make an incentive system for reporting.
Yes, we still look at it.
Like a chocolate.
But we can take it off the.
Last time, yeah.
We still look at it, but we're taking it out of our corrective action plan, but we still look at it. The other thing that, since you, that is a really a quality improvement activity, but it's not an official quality improvement activity, is our critical incident review committee, because we review every level 3 incident, and we review the provider response to every level 3 incident. And any time we have a question or concern about their lack of response or the way they responded, then we investigate the provider. So that, even though it's not an official quality improvement activity, it is looking at the dangerous activities, the dangerous events.
Well, if you identify a pattern or
yes.
a weakness or whatnot. But I think you need to look also at rapid cycle. Rapid cycle intervention. I mean, you see where there's a problem, and you say, "Well, let's get let's hire Uber to get people to their appointments." And then you already have your baseline. You put that into effect, and 3 months later, you look at it. You know, this shouldn't always be a year. You know, because there's
things that need to be fixed. And legislation requires that we implement it for a year. We don't expect to wait a year for a result. We expect it, like when we did the ED report,
if we make a change to policy, it has to be for a year, or if we do?
No, the project.
If we identify a project.
You track it for a year.
Okay.
You might want your change to, you definitely want your change to occur before the end of that year. That's not your target date for the change, but that's how long we have to track it.
Do you have different levels of?
Our quality improvement activities that aren't actually projects
yes.
would be more like what you're talking about.
They could be about the cycle time.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I'll shut up. Thank you.
And those, we get quarterly reports on those in our quality improvement committee, and those goals roll off as soon as they're achieved.
Good. I see.
No, I think that's great, Jack. Thank you. That clarified some of that for me, too.
If you are interested in attending one of our quality improvement committee meetings, we do it by phone. I can have you invited.
It'll be fine.
Okay.
Now that you're retired, you've got all this spare time? Yeah, sign up for another.
Yeah, talk again and I'll invite you to something else.
I'm not worried about that.
No, we welcome any new insights, and anytime we can get feedback.
No, I really appreciate Jack and Pat, what y'all bring to this from personal experience and being in the field is invaluable.
We're lucky to have him on this.
Yeah, he's asking the right questions. So you just keep talking, Jack.
I've been there before.
Yes. Well, good. If there's no other business, then I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion.
Is there a second?
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Well, we had a